He's been playing with David Bowie since the Diamond Dogs tour of 1974. Give it up for Mr. Earl Slick. Right to the start, when did you start playing guitar and why?
1964, Beatles on Ed Sullivan Show. Me and about a million other kids. It was February 9th, 1964, I remember the date. And the next day we all came to school and all of our, we used to, you know, grease in the hair back. The grease was gone, everybody had bangs, and we were putting bands together before we could even play. And then when I saw the Stones, that was it.
We're in the Gibson Showroom here in Las Vegas.
Yes, we are.
What was your first experience with a Gibson?
My first experience was I bought a 1964 SG Junior in 1965. I used that on all the early Bowie records, the John Lennon records.
You just mentioned David Bowie. You started playing with him. You replaced Mick Ronson on the 74 Diamond Dogs tour. You were on the David Live recording.
That was my first recording.
And then the first studio album was Young Americans.
Yeah.
You know, Song Division's focus is obviously on the songwriting process. Can you share with everyone a little bit of the creative process on the Young Americans recording?
He would bring in the songs. I mean, the lyrics would be done, and the basic chord structure would be there, but it was up to us to come up with the little nuances and the parts and those, the sounds, and, you know. So there was participation in that way, and it was more done like a band would do it.
For the first time played you one of those songs, have you ever told him that it sucks?
Yeah. And plenty of times where I played him a lick that I thought was brilliant, he goes, "That sucks." I mean, you can't be polite about it.
It's a very relaxed. It's
totally relaxed. Yeah, and it's not. It sucks in a bad way. It sucks like we laugh about it. Kind of, it sucks, you know. Because if you take it, if you're thin-skinned, you're not gonna have fun.
You're not gonna last very long.
You're not gonna last very long at all in the business.
Young Americans, amazing album. Station to Station, one of the most critically well-received albums of all time. The song "Stay,"
which is
a signature.
I timed it once. There's 6 minutes of my lick and 2 minutes of vocals.
Right. Could you play a little bit of "Stay" for
us? Yeah.
You played on the Valentine's Day single.
Mm-hmm.
So if you haven't heard it yet, the latest Bowie single, "Valentine's Day," which is out, is all the guitars.
Yeah. Musically, it's, you know, it's not a heavy song, and, you know, melodically and band-wise, it's kind of lighthearted. It's not a sinister song, but is the subject matter is about the school shootings and you know, and a gun control sort of thing.
So, love to come back and talk with you about your work with John Lennon. Before we do that, would you play us a song that you recorded on John Lennon?
Can they play with me?
B.O. What you got?
Come to record and play with John Lennon?
I got a call from Jack Douglas. My manager did. Jack Douglas goes back to very early Lennon recordings, as well as Aerosmith and a whole bunch of other people. And Jack's a really great producer.
Yeah.
But they wouldn't tell me who it was for like a couple of weeks. And then finally, I just started thinking about who could it be that under the radar that they couldn't tell me about it. And I kind of, we guessed. I told my manager, tell him it's John Lennon and see how he reacts. And that's what we found out.
And then when you finally meet him, which is something I'd like to ask, with David Bowie, John Lennon, you know, these guys are, you know, as famous as it gets. Guys who have been famous under a white hot spotlight since their late teens, all their lives, you know, there's got to be some defences up there. So when you meet these guys, how do you connect with them? Is it through the music? Is it through a joke? How do you actually get personal with them?
Sometimes you don't. When you first meet them, though, if you're just yourself, I find that not giving a shit really works for me. Because they're just people, you know. And when I met Bowie, the whole audition process was the most bizarre thing I'd ever seen in my life anyway. And by the time he actually walked in the room, because I auditioned by myself, looking at a control room glass that was completely blacked out, and playing to songs I never heard before with headphones on. And then he walked out and we just kind of broke open a drink and played some guitars and chatted, and it was very comfortable.
And with John?
With John, we'd worked together on Young Americans, according to the credits and according to everybody involved, including John. And I, when we, the first day of Double Fantasy, I'd...
On Fame?
Yeah. And I'm credited for something else on the album I don't remember playing on.
Right.
And I walked in a Hit Factory, and I got there early because I wanted to kind of get set up. That I was a little nervous about, you know, because I was a big, out of all the Beatles, I was a big John fan because his stuff was, you know, dark. Paul was making these pop records, but John was writing songs like Cold Turkey and doing, you know, much more what I liked. And he was outspoken, and to me, he was sort of the Keith Richards of the Beatles, you know, the loose cannon guy. So I was excited to get there. So I got there early and I walk in the room. There's nobody there but him. And I went, ah, shit. So I walked over and I introduced myself, and he had said, nice to see you again. And I said, have we met? And he says, yeah, when we did that Bowie record and, you know, remember we did Fame and all this other stuff. I said, I hate.
You blew off John Lennon.
This is really bad, but I don't remember. And we had a good laugh about it. And on and off during the course of the next couple of months, every once in a while, he goes, do you remember me now?
So Double Fantasy and Milk and Honey, and correct me if I'm wrong here, it was all part of the one session,
yeah,
recording session, and mm-hmm. It was sort of put into
what,
album.
What had happened was that John and Yoko had written X amount of songs. And so we just recorded them. As there was no sort of like, well, this is going to go on this record and that's going to go on that record. We just did two albums worth of material, and basically Double Fantasy is the product of the first batch of songs that were picked. And then the rest of them were going to be worked on and finished at the beginning of 1981, but that didn't happen for John. So about 2 or 3 years down the line, Yoko gave permission and they went in and they mixed what we had, without really adding to it, because, you know, all the vocals and all that were live. And
the song that we just heard, Nobody Told Me,
sounded like when we recorded it. So we weren't sitting there Pro Tools in our ass off, punching in a note here and fixing a vocal there and auto-tuning stuff. I mean, that's what we sounded like.
We've got a gig tomorrow at the Aria. After mm-hmm. that, you fly back to New York for rehearsals with the Plastic Ono band. So
yeah.
you're still hanging out with Yoko.
Yeah,
and
I hadn't
Sean
seen Yoko in years, and a really, really good documentary producer named Michael Epstein did a film called Lennon NYC, which, you know, not just because I'm in the film, but it was...
Has anyone seen that? It's a fantastic,
it covers John's life while he was in New York, from the time he moved there until the end. So I saw her during that filming of that, and then we were invited to play at the Meltdown Festival, and she was the curator, which basically means she was the headliner and sort of set the mood of it by picking certain other acts that she liked to be on the festival. So we performed Double Fantasy live for the first time ever.
Hey, everyone, give it up for Earl Slick.
Thanks, guys.
Thanks, boss.
He loves to be loved.